So actually, should we get it started?
Okay.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. It's our great honor to have Professor Linda Katehi joining us today. Linda will kick off our summer computer engineering distinguished lecture talk series. And of course, we'll also have a set of high-profile speakers from both academia and industry joining us every week. And today, Linda will be talking about incorporating intelligence into high-frequency circuit design. And before her talk, I want to give a brief introduction about Linda. Linda is currently a distinguished TES chair professor at Texas A&M. She's a member of National Academy of Engineering, NAE, and the National Academy of Inventors. So in the administration role, she has served as chancellor at UT Davis, provost at the University of Illinois, dean of engineering at Purdue, and associate dean at the University of Michigan. Linda also made a significant technical contributions in actually high-frequency circuit design, MEMS, packaging, and applied electromagnetics. 25 of her PhD students have become faculty members in the United States and abroad. So let's welcome our speaker.
Thank you very much. My pleasure to participate in this series of lectures. And so today I will speak about an area that I'm getting into. It's different in some ways from what I've done in the past, but I consider this to be a continuation and a forward, if you like, a pathway to electronics. So to explain and talk about the motivation behind introducing intelligence in electronic circuits and specifically in high-frequency electronics, I just want to talk a little more about the spectrum and how the usage of the spectrum is morphing in these years and how it's going to be in the many years to come. So, according to Cisco, in 3 years from now, we'll have about 3 times Earth's population in wireless users. So about 25 billion or so will be the wireless users that have unique wireless devices. And then in addition to that, of course, we have a number of satellites that are sent continuously out there for all kinds of different missions. Some are commercial, primarily to support these wireless communications. Other are satellites that do Earth observations. Other are government satellites. There are satellites coming from all governments around the world and different companies. And then, of course, you have the astronomers and the major huge arrays, in fact, that have been, or telescopes, individuals, telescopes in some cases, that have been developed to be able to observe different, to look for information, radio signals in deep space. And on the other end, you have the military for, of course, their own needs in terms of space. And you can see how crowded that space can get in a real active theater. So when we look at this type of an environment, which in fact is growing by leaps and bounds, and as a matter of fact, according to Euler's law, it doubles every 2 years. So they use the number of digital users doubles every 2 years, and in about 10 years from now, the wireless users will be many more than the ones we had that we will have at the time that will use a wired digital communication. So we are talking about an environment of wireless users, and a lot of them will be using very small individual devices that will have to communicate effectively with high quality of service and high quality of experience. So that brings me to the topic of embodied intelligence and the need to start thinking about incorporating it as an integral part of our design. So I will talk about the body, the importance of the body to intelligence. And there is always a body to every wireless system. So the body could be a robotic. It could be just a phone that has different types of sensors. Now there are some biomedical sensors also connected to the phone. Of course, there is a camera.
It's
and so forth. Or you may have a satellite that has phased arrays, sensor, of course, in electronic sensor. You have other types of sensors, optical sensors maybe, or other systems that may have sensors for the environment and so forth. So all of this is the body. And then I would like to talk about how that impacts the intelligence and how can be utilized to develop that intelligence. Then I would like to go to electronics and what really it means to introduce intelligence in electronics. So I spoke about the need for the appropriate use of the spectrum. Let's use that as an example to understand where intelligence really can solve a problem that is piling up as time goes on. The spectrum, including both the software and hardware platforms that are actively operating in that environment, it's a very complex and continuously growing network. And to be able to manage this space effectively, because it seems like the spectrum is a limited resource. In reality, it's not a limited resource. From the time, for example, you start going into the extremes of the size, both at the low end or the high end, then of course you don't have limitations there. But with our technological capacities and capabilities today, it seems to be like a limited resource. And from that point of view, with so many systems operating in that relatively small available space, electronic space, you do understand that you need to have the capability to manage this network of millions or billions of devices, needs to have the capability to manage itself. And of course, to manage itself in real time and become available on demand and effectively, you will need to have a system that can do it on its own without human intervention. And of course, it's not just the system or whatever. Whenever we say system, we mean billions of individual networks that will be able to control themselves and them as members of a very large community of similar networks and do it on their own and supervised successfully and without human intervention. So every time in the past we have talked about intelligence, we do what you see here on the right, which is usually we put something around, we visualize intelligence as a characteristic of our brain. But then if we go back in history, then we'll realize that that was a philosophy that was developed 500 years ago. And almost, and it was Descartes' philosophy or the Cartesius philosophy that said that the brain controls the body. As a matter of fact, he said the very famous, I think, therefore I am. However, philosophy really created the foundation for a lot of beliefs we developed and a lot of directions in science and in technology that we took for many, many years. However, in the last 20 years or so, and especially more intensely in the last 10 years, then people have started realizing by observing nature and by learning about evolution in a much more effective and scientific way than before, that the body is an equal partner to the brain when it comes to guiding our decisions and emotions. And from that point on, that people started talking about embodied intelligence, meaning that both the body and the brain are equal actors in that. There is a lot of information that has been published in the last few years, and I will give you an example of the octopus. It's a very well-known animal species, and we all always thought, you know, in fact, is the basis of food for many cultures around the world, including my own. I was born in Greece, But then nobody thought that the octopus had any form of intelligence, all right, as we don't believe that many other species do have intelligence. Yet the work that has been done recently has shown that the octopus has the intelligence of a five-year-old child. And the most interesting thing is that its intelligence is managed and is expressed in different ways from how humans do or many other mammals. So, for example, the octopus does not have a skeleton, and that makes the needs of how it decides what to do, how to move, and how to learn totally different from the human body. So the human body has a skeleton, and the brain has a small replica of this skeleton in the form of coordinates. So the brain can decide how to move our legs, our hands, and everything, and do it in a way that is appropriate. So when we extend our hand, then we can reach a cup on a table, and we can reach it successfully and grab it. Now, with the octopus that has eight legs and they're all soft, so there is no skeleton in the body, it would be extremely complex and time-consuming for the brain of the octopus to have a complete replica of the body in all its possible positions in the form of coordinates. That's not possible because it's the body of the octopus can flex in unlimited ways. So what happens then is there is no control from the central lobe of the octopus of the legs. The legs control themselves on their own, which means that the octopus has many lobes and one of them is totally distributed on the skin of the octopus. So the skin of the octopus has neurons which store information and process information, and then they make some local decisions. So when the octopus, for example, decides with one leg to hold an object, that decision was made locally by that leg. And then the main lobe of the octopus, which is below its eye, and this eye cannot even see very well, I have to say, so does not really have a knowledge about the activities of that leg. However, I wanted to also point out that all of the calculations are analog. Many of the calculations are morphological, meaning they don't even, they are done very locally, and they are done because of the properties, by using the properties of the materials of the skin, for example, and the muscles locally and so forth. So it's a very interesting way where information is processed, and then only if the information from an experience of one leg is important to reach the central lobe, because maybe the whole octopus needs to move from that location. That's only when hierarchically a piece of information goes higher and then is processed. So I just wanted to give you that in mind as we think about intelligence for electronics. So also when I used to differentiate the two words that many times we use interchangeably and for wrongly, obviously, cognition shows the process of learning. Intelligence is the manifestation of cognition, and then it's based on learning. So you may have a body or an animal that has a full cognitive capability, but if it's prevented from learning, then will never grow its intelligence. And there is more variation in the learning process than there is variation in the cognitive capabilities, which also tells us, you know, in the long term, that a lot of times we try to measure intelligence and then we mean cognition. But in reality, cognition is a lot more similar among people, and their intelligence is all in the manifestation on what they learn, how they learn, and how they use their cognitive skills and capabilities, how many opportunities they had for learning, that really defines the level of what we mean intelligence. So principles of embodied intelligence, there are three specific goals that are achieved in an embodied intelligence. So first of all, if you have a system that is truly intelligent, it's characterized by these three characteristics. So first of all, there is a sensory control coordination. So there is an appropriate capability to allow for the body to develop to develop this coordination. So practically, you can use sensory information and use that as feedback to be able to provide the appropriate control. So that is critical. That kind of capability is important in design. Then morphological computations. What that implies is the following, that if your body is specialized for a given task, then it will require less energy to achieve it. So for example, a jaguar, an animal, is defined, its body is specifically defined for very high speeds. And it can achieve those high speeds with much less energy than another species that has not been designed for that. Which also says the following, at least for us doing electronics, that if we are to develop a system that is perfect for, is optimized for a given task, not only its capabilities, electronic capabilities have to be designed that way, but also its body, meaning the combination of sensors that will need to provide the appropriate data and that the materials we're using for these sensors, if they have been optimized for the task, then the energy that this net system is going to require to achieve this task is going to be much lower. And then the final thing is the following. It needs to have an intelligent system, needs to have the capability to learn. As I said before, you may develop the system itself and then develop perfectly its cognitive capacity. But if the system cannot learn from its own experiences, whether these are electronic sensory, electronic data or other sensory data, if it can only learn from that, it will never become intelligent. And there are now, there are developed deep machine learning and lifelong learning methods and algorithms which allow an intelligent system to learn from these experiences and develop what we call a self model, which in fact is nothing else but the DNA, if you like, the electronic DNA of a system that characterizes every part of it. And not only they can develop it for themselves, but they can export it. And which means that you can have one electronic system to learn from an environment. And then the moment this system develops a self-model, then another system can acquire that self-model without having to go through the same learning capabilities. Now, what is not intelligence, especially for our field, and because we've used the word smart, intelligent, and so forth many times. So what is not intelligent is the programmed adaptation. Where, for example, we say, okay, we are going to develop a system for the future, and then this is what we want the system to do, X, Y, and Z. And then we allow the system to do either X or Y or Z or any combination of those depending on the scenario. Well, that's not intelligence. It's kind of programmed adaptation. And also reconfigurability. We create a fixed menu of specific electronic or physical reconfigurations, and then we design the system to be able to do any of the above or a combination. So what is intelligence is to have a system, have a set of capabilities, and then for the system, on the basis of its sensory data, including electronic data, to decide how to operate in that continuous environment. And so, make the decision without a human intervention. And as a matter of fact, make decisions not out of any particular list or menu list, which implies that if that system is forced to operate in a new environment for which it was not programmed, designed, then this system is not going to fail, but it's going to try to operate. It may not operate perfectly, but as time goes by, it's going to improve its operation until it achieves the kind of accuracy that the system has been designed to achieve. So, what is the difference between a traditional electronic system and a stochastic system? It's very simple, in fact, to think about it. So, the systems that we have developed so far, and you can see, for example, I used in this particular one a schematic of the nanosats. The satellites have become smaller and smaller, and then the smaller they become, the easier then it gets to launch them, and then the smaller they are, they can be launched as a swarm of satellites, and then you can do all kinds of different things. All of these satellites that we have developed so far are the result of deterministic design processes, which means we have a deterministic engine. What is a deterministic engine? For those who remember, you know, boundary value problems, it's like a system that is designed. It has very specific solutions within the design space, and time can be part, of course, one of the coordinates. And then it is designed for those solutions, and then we know after we design it, if the design has been successful, that it's going to provide all of these solutions because that's how we develop the system. However, to allow for intelligence to develop, which means that the system may have to take a decision different from what we even imagine. But of course, it has to be guided by specific policies, all right? It's not going to be like any possible, and we will have to constrain and provide specific constraints for security, safety, and other things for the policies. But other than policies that will be required in the operation of the system, then the system by itself is going to decide on how to react to a given environment on the basis of the inputs that it's receiving. Systems like that, to be able to operate without failing, they need to have the capability to compute the stochastic properties of the signals they try to improve, of the operations of the signals, the signals they receive, the data they receive, the operations. They need to understand the stochastic properties of the system itself, and they need to optimize its operation on the basis of those. They need to have what we call a stochastic engine. They need to operate on the basis of a probability of success, and they need, on the basis of that, to achieve a performance that will satisfy a given degree of accuracy, and they may have to try more than once to get there. But the moment they get to that degree of accuracy, they will remain there until something changes in their environment. So to look at the design process for intelligent electronics, on the left side, you see the block diagram for a software-defined radio. It is a deterministic system. It does provide what I call a linear integration in the design process. So what we do, for example, is we assume that every component is a separate box, and then we design every component. Of course, we do it in a way so the whole system has a particular performance, but it is what I call linear integration. You individually design those, and then eventually we put them together to have a performance. For a truly intelligent system like this one, there is no linear integration. It's all a co-design. It's the full integration incorporates takes into consideration the sensor control relationships, computations that have to take place. The computations have to take place not necessarily all at the same place, but in a distributed way. Some computations have to be done independently of others. They all have to be done in real time and with the lowest possible energy. And of course, the ability to learn, to store information that was useful and to use this information for, to incorporate this information back into the system and change the system itself or the self-model of the system. So the next time that a similar change in the environment takes place, now the system can behave a lot better. And so that requires a total, the ability of the system to change itself. And you cannot have a system that can change itself or its performance in the linear type of design that we have followed. It does require a totally different design. And as a matter of fact, it does require the ability to bring a lot of this on the same platform and make them part of the same processing node of the system. Now, one example, as I said, if I were to go back and say the following, what components will be important in designing an intelligent system? First of all, the ability to understand the body of the system and knowing that its body will be critical in its performance. Even electronic performance, which in the past we have not considered, all right? I mean, yes, in some ways you can say, well, by looking at the electronic performance of the antennas, that practically in some ways I do take the body into consideration. But now I'm talking more about that. I mean, to really be able to have to be in a dynamic environment that changes in real time and sometimes unexpectedly, you really need to have a body that you really understand and be able to utilize when it's needed appropriately. So a better understanding, a good understanding of the body as part of your calculations when you are looking at how to respond as an electronic system is important. And of course, deep machine learning capabilities. I apologize for moving back, but deep machine learning capabilities here are important to be part of the system, the lifelong learning methodologies and algorithms, and of course, the ability to do computations in a distributed manner and to do computations not in a digital way and not try to move billions of data from one place of the system to another, trying to take advantage of the capability to calculate specific things in one place and then only use the information when it is critical. And do it in an analog and neuromorphic computing, if possible, to be able to save energy. Now, this is one example of where you can see there are different things that can be done. Of course, the ideal of one system that is totally intelligent, that has a body that can morph according to what needs to be done and all of this, this is a long-term vision of a system like that. There are many steps that we can take between now and should take between now and then. And there are a lot of learning we need to do along the process to be able to get there. But we have the means to do that. So I need to give you an example of a system where you can do in real time computations that using digital computing would have been very difficult to do otherwise. So that shows a small sensor that you can put on a small UAV that practically it has an antenna or a few antennas. It has a camera. It has a small FPGA practically to take the different inputs from maybe the array, the antenna. It could be analog here. It could be digital from the camera and so forth. You could have other sensors. But you bring everything. You make them digital in this particular case. And then you take them to a Loihi that changes those bits into spikes. And then it makes all the calculations into real time. And why is that important? First of all, there are two things that happen when you do neuromorphic computations, which are important to us. First of all, on the Loihi, the Loihi is an Intel neuromorphic chip that is based on the 14 nanometer CMOS. The structure that has been used is a crossbar configuration. You may know what a crossbar configuration is, but it's a way of connecting, like a crossbar, as it says, the CMOS, so that your computations, instead of using Kirchhoff's laws primarily, for those of you, you can go and Google crossbar CMOS, and you can see a number of papers that have been published recently about how a crossbar computation exists. But what it really allows you to do is to reduce the number of your calculations. So in a digital, on a chip that does manipulate bits or computes different functions using bits, using the traditional digital computation, the best you can do when you have to multiply a vector and a known vector with a matrix to find your output, if you have a square matrix n by n, the best you can do nowadays using all kinds of symmetries and so forth is n log n. With a crossbar configuration, you can go down to n. And as a matter of fact, if you replace your CMOS with a combination between memory stores and CMOS, people are working is what we call one-shot computation, which means that you can compute the product between an n by n matrix and a vector that has size n with one shot. That primarily reduces to almost nothing your computations, but they have to be in an analog form. Now, what is also the other important thing about using spikes? That you go from bits to spikes using and the amount of energy that a bit carries. So you do not necessarily change. There are bits, for example, that will not change into spikes unless there is enough of energy carried by those bits. And that implies that you will reduce your number of spikes is much lower than the number of bits that you would normally have to compute in a digital configuration. So now that shows another combination of these two. So for example, if you have a much more complex spectrum, and then you get multiple channels, practically you get values of electronic signals coming from, you know, from multiple users. Those have stochastic properties because, of course, they have been altered in the real environment by all kinds of different noises and so forth. They can all go into an FPGA, they turn into bits, and then you move those into a neuromorphic computer to do all of your calculations. So practically, the matrix that you see here, which is a BAE product, and it was developed under DARPA, program some time ago. And then the FPGA, what they do is they sample the signal and they take those samples into bits. And then they go here, the Intel Loihi, or you may have a combination of Loihis, changes that to spikes. And then here you can have a deep neural network that does all of the calculations, have all of the signal processing. So at the end, primarily, you have signals that come out of this microprocessor that really give you information about the direction of arrival. They can talk about modulation, about the platform of the different users or the different emitters, and all kinds of other information that you may want to have. So there are now, let's move one step further. We talked about one hybrid where for one step you have turned your digital computations into analog. So in many of these, you will not really have, I mean, if you don't necessarily have to have bits to go into a Loihi. Intel has done that because they were envisioning using the Loihi with many other sensors that may give digital signals. In reality, when you have an analog signal and you can sample it, then you can use those samples to create spikes, and then from there to do the analog calculations. So you can use a deep neural network primarily to have the performance of any of your systems. And you can say, well, how do I know that that's possible? How can I do that in the first place? How can I find this deep neural network that will allow this chip, in this particular case, the Loihi could be another one. As a matter of fact, the TSMC does have a line where it can create those chips for you. And then in fact, also it can use memory stores in addition to that. But in any case, the question is, okay, how am I going to find this deep neural network that allows this chip to perform like a receiver and do all of these kinds of calculations of the various stochastic properties of the incoming signals? There is now that takes me into the most recent progress that has been done in applied mathematics. And what we've learned in the last 10 years is the following. In fact, we rediscovered something that was done almost 100 years ago. So in 1931, Koopman and von Neumann together, they proved a theorem that said that any system, especially talking about nonlinear systems, that is ergodic. So it does not have singularities. It does not create power out of nothing. I mean, a system that has it's an ergodic system. That system can be characterized to any degree of accuracy by a linear operator, and that is called the Koopman operator. Now, the problem at the time, even if that really is a major proposition and of extremely important, because if you remember, for those of you who design circuits, the first thing they tell you, if you want to find a transfer function, you have to have a linear system. And then if you have a linear system, then you find a linear operator, which in fact is the transfer function. And then the linear operator, which in time domain, as a matter of fact, we use it in frequency domain most of the time because it's just a product. Then this operator is going to characterize the system. And then a lot of times that's how we do the designs. For example, in all linear, you know, linear designs, primarily we're looking at, we start at least with the transfer function. And we use that for different types of operation. The filters is an example. Now, the fact that any nonlinear system can be represented by a linear function is a big deal, because then you can say, okay, my whole receiver now, which is a nonlinear system because it has all these nonlinear elements, and then historically, what we do is that we characterize them, we find equivalent circuits that are valid over the linear region, and then we stick with that, and then we try to then make the design there, and there from, at least for the receiver, and then the only other thing that we may do is to look outside of the linearity of the linear region, and then, or stability region where we design it, and then somehow find out what the byproducts can be that we may do something, if we can, to reduce them. But now, if I go back to what I said, and then if I can find this Koopman operator, then I can really design this network very easy. Also, in the last 2 or 3 years, maybe I would say in the last 5 years, just to be more accurate, there has been a lot of work in applied mathematics and in mechanical engineering, where they look at flow problems, where in fact they have demonstrated that it is very easy to develop a deep neural network that has as values of the various synapses, the weights, I would say, the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of this Koopman operator. And then as a matter of fact, if you have those, then practically knowing the Koopman operator for a system, then for a given input, you find the output. Now, how do you find this Koopman operator? They have also demonstrated that the Scoopman operator can be calculated out of data. So for example, if I have lots of radios that talk to each other and I can then record all of these measurements, and we have lots of data when it comes to spectrum and radios and so forth, or satellite communications and all of this. If I have a lot of this data for a system, and I could also combine both experimental and theoretical data. So if I have, for example, take a filter, to just make it simple, filter is linear, but let's assume that I have a filter. Just I will try to describe that, and the same thing applies to a receiver, a full receiver. If I have a filter, and then I can go to MATLAB and create a lot of data, and maybe I have a combination of measurements from a successful filter that I did, and then some data from measurements, other data from calculations. I can create a synthetic database, and then I can use that to find the deep neural network that has the kind of performance. Now, so for example, I can use MATLAB to create the performance of an ideal filter. So I can use this data, I can find a deep neural network that creates this ideal filter. And then I can use that deep neural network on an analog chip to make that microprocessor perform like a filter, like an ideal filter. So you can ask, okay, so where is the catch? Because obviously there is no free lunch anywhere. Well, the problem in this case will be errors or noise, if you like. They will come out of two areas. One, on how big was the Koopman operator, how many eigenfunctions and eigenvalues you utilize to find the deep neural network for this Koopman operator. And then second, of course, will be the noise that you have from the analog computing. Now, in both areas, I think you can get down to 10 to minus 9 kind of computational errors from both sides. But in any case, your errors then will come out of noise of these two steps that you have to incorporate in your design. Okay, so now this is, I will not go very in great detail here, but this is how it shows how you, the Koopman operator and how you create that. The other one thing I want to bring to your attention is that what is amazing in this Koopman operator is, and that applies to other problems, for example, in climate change. Now, you may have a lot of measurements in different parameters in climate change, and those can be temperature, can be pressure in the atmosphere, can be humidity, can be all kinds of different things. And then you don't know what the inputs of this to this system have been. You have no idea, you know, how many different parameters were able to create all of these things, to impact the system so we can see the measurements today. The Koopman operator does not really need that to be able to make projections. So you can use the Koopman operator only from the output measurements, from what we call here Y. And then you can find Y, K plus 1, K is in time. So you can find projections of the output from the output at previous times without even knowing the input. And that's in fact what what is used now for climate change, for epidemics, for all of these huge problems that cannot be characterized and for which we may not even know what the inputs are. And that's why this is such an important thing. Here is exactly how you use your input and output data to find, you use the deep neural network, you use an encoder and decoder, and practically from here, you find here K there, which is your Koopman operator, and you can use that to develop your deep neural network. And then, of course, I talked about deep machine learning. I'm not going to have too many things here other than saying that it is important to develop a self-model for your intelligent system. It will allow mobility where your system can mobilize itself and move. It sensory identification, so you receive a lot of data. You can identify what you see, what you hear, and then whatever what we characterize as a sensory. Of course, wireless signal identification, we call it spectrum, and recognition and identification. Practically, you can find whoever is speaking with you, what they say, where they come from, what devices they use. And of course, then collect data, this data, and then use them for a supervised learning. Use the supervised learning to update your self model, store important data, and then use your self model to improve your performance. What is important in all of this is socializing. What means is that your system needs to connect, of course, with the other systems to be able to make decisions in real time. Of course, learning and replication is extremely important in these systems. So I'm not going to say much here about the lifelong learning. There is a whole area of research, of inquiry, where people are talking about machine-to-machine communications and lifelong learning capabilities and so forth. These are some other ideas on how, I mean, I talked a little bit about the filter and how you can create that filter. So, for example, you can have an incoming RF signal. You will be able to sample it, and then you will be able these samples to send them into an analog chip. In this particular case, it's a memristor-based crossbar configuration. I talked about the crossbar configuration. And then you develop your deep neural network, and then you make this chip here perform as a filter that has the capability to do things that other filters that we normally develop the traditional way cannot do. And this is the work that I, with my graduate students, are working at this moment. So these are some ideas, and you will find that in literature on how crossbar configurations work and how you, for example, can have, instead of n log n calculations, you go to just n. And there is, as I said, in place research going on for what they call one-shot computations. The other thing, the last thing I wanted to say, is that here is also results from studies that have been done to characterize similar types of problems. You see here, for example, a vector size n, and that implies if you want to find n coefficients or n unknowns, you have an n by n matrix in a linear system. And here you saw, you see results that have been done using Atom. This is like a digital microprocessor. This is photonic microprocessors that do analog. And this is Loihi. This is, in fact, a Loihi FPGA with memristors for the one-shot calculations. But you can see here two things. The difference between n vis-a-vis n log n. You can see how when you go to much higher values for the size of your vector, you say this deviation between the Loihi computations that go as n and the digital. And the reasons are, of course, in digital, you need to remember that you store in your digital your data in one place, you process them somewhere else, and then they bringing them from one place to another creates a major bottleneck. Which is called the von Neumann bottleneck or whatever in these digital computations, which in fact you don't have on a crossbar memristor chip because you store and you process things at the same place. The photonic now, even if it's an analog and they do it on a crossbar configuration as well, it's limited by noise. So for example, all in, if you are to do very many calculations using photonics, then you need to bring your photonic lines very close to each other, and there is coupling. And at least for now, in this kind of approach, you see that you can only go up to 4 or 5 bits. You cannot really, or higher than that, maybe not higher than that, because at some point when you go to 8 bits, for example, then your signal and the noise, because they have to bring the lines much closer, and some other noise inherent to the photonic materials then it shows that it's higher than the signal itself in the calculation. So it has increased noise, even if, because it's a crossbar, it has the same slope as you see with a CMOS-based crossbar configuration, which is the Loihi. So this is my last slide, and I wanted to stop here and then see whether you have any questions or you would like to have a discussion about some of these topics that I covered. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Linda, for the great presentation. Any questions from the audience? Oh, hi, Linda. Actually, I have one question.
Okay.
In this synthetic filter example you've shown,
yes,
as the last example, is, yes, this 1 to 20 gigahertz sample and the whole circuit also commercially, yes, available?
Yes. As a matter of fact, samplers nowadays, yes, up to 20 gigahertz commercially available. In higher frequencies, people have done a lot of work in sampling, and there are a lot of designs, in fact, that people have done sampling up to 40 gigahertz. And now with devices that are available with FT and FMAX that is higher within the, 400-500 gigahertz, then you can do sampling at even higher frequencies. So when you are in the 5G, for example, you can use that effectively. Now, if you go to submillimeter waves and the submillimeter wave region, and then you need to do sampling there, then obviously you will need to have appropriate devices, but then the whole thing is true, all right? I mean, if you are to develop a system, you need the same devices, not only for the sampling, but also for anything else that you will do in the system. You need devices that have high FTs and FMAX. But yeah, there are very good designs, as a matter of fact, as long as you follow the sampling guidelines and you sample enough. Usually for our applications, we go 4 times. I mean, we go high enough for the sampling.
And then what if we want to further control the filter response? So we have shown an example of bandpass. What if, yeah, we want to do a bandstop? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what happens is, especially with a crossbar configuration, so your filter response is nothing else but a control signal. So for example, if your control signal is 000111 over frequencies now, all right? So let's think you have a bandpass that has, it's like an ideal bandpass. So it's 000 and then goes 1111 for the band and then goes down to 000. You can use that as a control signal, and that's what is going to behave like a bandpass filter. And I'm telling you that the error that is going to come out of how many samples you're using, how many time samples you're using to make the calculations and how accurate your calculations are. But considering that you can make those within nanoseconds of calculations, of computation, I mean, you can do real-time sampling and computations in less than 100 microseconds. So practically, your filter within less than 100 microseconds or within 100 microseconds can change from a bandpass to a bandstop to whatever else you want it to be. The same kind of thing, the same filter. So that is what it allows you to do, some things that with deterministic systems we could not do in the past. And it's not going to have, the other thing, it's not going to have parasitic bands because it's not based on an LC system.
Yeah. Not
to do that.
And the one follow-up question, maybe my last question, is assuming we input is a zero, okay, ideally we reject everything down to noise floor, but
yes,
practically it will be limited by the crosstalk or by any parasitic path within the crossbar. Is that correct?
Oh, there are no, the crossbar is nothing else but a computer. Mm-hmm. So you call that the computing error, right? Yes,
yeah,
of course there will be. Yes. And usually they, from what I know, in their calculations, 10 to minus 9 to 10 to minus 12, depending. So it's 10 to minus 9. So they have even used up to 12 bits. their calculations carefully, and they say I haven't developed, of course, those computers, but I think for a 10^-9 in the accuracy of the signal, that's practically 9 × 20, all right, in power. And I would not say it's -180. There is no way in a dBm, but I would say that it's at least down to -90 dBm in the noise. At least I expect it. That's something that, of course, has to be studied on what kind of noise you receive. It's going to be a totally different type of noise, as you can imagine. It's not going to be the same. It's going to be something else. As I said, you know, you don't expect that to be ideal. But this is what is interesting to see, that what are the byproducts of that new implementation. But on the basis of what has been done so far, it seems like that the noise will be at a level that will be very good. That remains to be seen, obviously, and that's what we are looking for primarily, not just to see that you can realize this filter, but what kind of accuracies you get in its performance. What kind of errors?
Great. Any other questions from the audience? I think you can use the Q&A session. Okay, so if there's no other question, let's thank our speaker again. Great presentation. Thank you, Linda.
Thank you. Thank you.
And just a gentle reminder that we will have another high-profile speaker, Vida, who is a VP of Intel Lab, joining us next week. So please stay tuned. Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.